not how to play. I know it was a problem. So what happened was, my client was booked for yesterday, and yesterday in the morning, one of my clients said, can we have a meeting on Saturday to discuss automation? I said, you know, on Saturday I said I'm going to a conference, so it won't be possible. The moment I said that, it would have been like, I have to go for a conference on Saturday. But because of that, the client was supposed to be today itself, right? And by that time I was already in the office. So 9:30 I was in the office and 10 o'clock my client was there. So I missed him. And then again I booked another flight in the afternoon. I was running towards the airport with my laptop back. And there at the airport I was doing all kinds of shopping for my shirt and pants, everything. So that's how I reached here. So that was our context API. So this is what we are going to talk about today. Context API is a bit interesting to that, right? We will see today in detail about what exactly is Context API and how does it really help developers manage a lot of things in here. Okay, so we'll go through what is Context API, how to use Context API. How to use that is actually more important, right? Because we are developers, you know, we get something good, right? You just start using it everywhere. Like, you know, you got jQuery, you started using jQuery everywhere, you are wondering, you know, can I use jQuery in CSS also? So, well, how to use it? Then, use of render props versus hierarchy components in the context API. And then, listing of multiple providers. And there are a lot of things. Okay, so let's say you are a developer in your project and your project is about a retail website, right? So let's you know kind of these e-commerce sites where you go to a product page, you say add to basket, like this, and then there is this small icon on the top right corner which is incrementing the value, right? So let's say you have been interacting to create that kind of basket icon. So the purpose of that icon is just to show the number of items which have been added into your basket, and if the user clicks on that, then it should be redirected to the basket page. So generally we have something like this, right? Like two items have been added to the basket. So generally now this basket icon, right? So let's say it's not really about separation of concerns, it's about separation of components. So whenever I create one component at a time, that component is only thinking about, okay, how do I render myself? Okay, it doesn't really care about, okay, how to create this data. Like, you know, do I have to get an API call, okay, or do I have to get it from some database, some, you know, variable value, what exactly, like, where do I get the data from? The component says, I don't want to think about all these things. Just give me this value, the property, and I display it. It is your concern. Like, you know, it says that whoever is using it is my parent's concern. So you just take care of that. Give me the property as a, you know, like I said, basket comes, give me the value, and I just show it over here. So how it will happen is, let's say if it's a very simple application. Let's say this is my application component, and then this is the component hierarchy. So application component has basket icon as a giant. So application is kind of having a basket icon. And the application passes the basket com very nicely to this guy. So the application says that okay, you don't worry about getting the value. I will make what kind of follow-up by, you know, I'll make a call to the REST API behind, I'll get the value and give it to you. Or whenever the user is clicking on, let's say, a product, it is my address to get that value and I'll give it to you. But whenever the basket com is giving you, I'll be rendering properly. So this one works pretty well. Now, what happens is, generally we will not have just the basket front as an application. We will have an application page like this. We will have a content area. We will have a header like this at the top. And then the basket icon will be sitting somewhere over here on the top right corner. Now, the problem is, who will provide a value of 2 to this basket icon? Okay, so now what happens is, this is my application. This is where the basket icon is, and suddenly the header has popped up in between, right? The header says that, okay, you know what? Basket icon is going to be my child, and I am going to be a child of the application. So now this application is thinking, okay, how do I pass on this basket icon to basket com to the basket icon component so that it can show it properly? So maybe thinking of some other little way that, you know, I'll just pass on that, you know, but it doesn't work when React, but like the React is very deep, using all these other different transactions. So the way you have to do it is this way. So the application will have to take its child, where it is, the regular one, take this basket one, and give it to your system to somewhere down the hierarchy, somebody will need it. And here it says that, I don't know what this is, but okay, when you're saying basket one, I'll just pass on that basket one to my child. So this is where the problem is. The header is not really concerned with basket.com. As you know, the header just wants to say that, you know, I am supermarket.com and all these blue and slogans and things like that, all the new items. But it says, I don't really care about what is the basket.com, that is not my responsibility. But you are still passing on it on to me, so that I can pass it down further to the basket item. And this is something called as prop reading. Like prop reading, like generously, like even if it is not required, let us send it to this guy so that it can really down further to its unit. And the example that we just saw, this is actually a very simplistic example. Generally, what happens is there will be like a big header. And then you have to pass on a lot of access properties down the tree only so that your children somewhere down the hierarchy of children can actually learn, they will be able to receive the props properly. And this is something which was there in the React part, because React came out there. It was known as a view library. Its purpose was to make sure that if you want to render for you, you will do it the most convenient way. But they will not really have state management as a part of the core library. They never really thought that, okay, the application needs to pass on data like that. How can we handle it better? The only way we're doing is using state state in vanilla React app. And state state has this kind of property, because in state state, you can just pass on a property one by one to the label. Now, to add complexity to that, so let's say we are selling fruits, we are selling mango, banana, and now the problem is, the user would click on these add buttons, right? Instead of I want two bananas and three mangoes and things like that. And that kind of prompt should get updated over there in my basket icon. So it is not just that the data is going from top to bottom. The indication has got to go from this component back to top and from there back to the basket icon. And so this kind of thing kind of adds complexity in our applications. So this is how it now looks like. Because you have an application, this is our existing header in the basket icon, and this is the new product page, right? Where I am showing the list of products, and if I click on the add button in any one of these products, it has to raise some event that it will go up here. The application will know that, okay, now I need to increase my basket from because the user has tried to add some items to the product, and then that will go down from there. Now, see, like, there is so much of workflow happening for the basket com. There are a lot of places we do not really care about it. Like, especially this product page and the header page. This is because we don't really care about the basket com part, but we have to deal with it because so that I can connect the components properly. So, how can you solve this problem? The first one that we saw is using set state method in React, which is a very basic one, and this is what is causing us prop reading. If the components which don't want to be bothered about those properties, they still have to take those properties and send it to their children. What is the other way? This is the first thing that comes to our mind. Like, whenever we want to store some data, the first thing that comes to our desk developers is, okay, why can't I just have a variable somewhere? I can send a model variable. And I can have a basket model and local variable. Then this is the ability that we are taking. So that will just work fine. So, this is why global variables are evil, right? Because like, when you have so many of such variables and one guy is updating, other guy is taking it, very soon it becomes a bit unmanageable, right? Sometimes, suddenly, like, you know, you've got four mangoes, pretty simple, fine, and you don't know who exactly added to which one. Right? So, like, because it's global, you can just go and change it and manage the maintenance of your application and takes a hit because your application code is completely clean. We can solve it somehow with some good patterns, like let's say a singleton, so that we can have some more control over that. But still, this is one more major problem, that if I have a global variable, if one component is updating that, let's say if I click on the add button, and it is updating my basket from. There is no way for my basket icon to know that this is updated. It doesn't really generate any event. Right? So whenever the value changes, it doesn't really tell anybody that you know my value was changed. So if I'm using local variables, I am at a loss because I have to then keep on continuously calling the thing that you know, okay, has the basket form changed? Has the basket form changed? I can do it every 10 seconds. So that's why that's what really makes it work. What is the idea? Is a solution to that, and we'll see how. And then definitely, like if you have worked on any serious application, you will definitely use some state management tools like Redux, MobX. How many of you have used any of these tools? Can you say Redux? So this is our general solution, right? Like whenever you have to handle this kind of situation of moving data around an application, you will look for one of the state management tools. And the reason why these tools came up was because of a gap in React, because this state management was not really possible. And to tell you a secret, so this guys actually internally use Conversational UI. So you see right here. Okay. So what exactly is Conversational UI? This is going to help us in the state management of our application. It avoids prop reading, this schema, and it's part of React version 16.3, so the new version, not new anymore. So 2 days back, React released 16.4 also. But and but also we say that it's part of the new React version, it is not really so. So this was there in React since a very long time. It was just that it was kept under the hood. And it was also said that you know, this is some area you should never visit. You know, they have like been told statements from their government that do not use context API. And we always figured, you know, why not? And then they came up with a very nice API around it so that usage of context API is much more manageable. So now this is all, it is actually about our context API. This one liner actually summarizes the entire purpose. In here, we have this function called create context, which can take a default value or not. We'll see when. And then the moment we say create context, what exactly is the context? So React says that okay, now whenever you say create context, I am going to reserve a space for you. And then you do, like you know, you put whatever values or the variables you want in there, and just create a space for you. And these are the two items I'm going to provide you. One is the provider, the other one is the consumer. So this is more like the observable pattern that is here. So a provider is basically the one who is going to provide some value to be kept in the context. And consumer or consumers, there can be multiple consumers who are listening to that, they will actually be listening to any kind of change that happens into the variable that is put in the context API. So whenever the value changes in the variable that I'm stored in the context API, all my consumers will get to know. Okay. So this is how the code looks like. So let's say now I have defined one basket count equal to 1. So so this is not global variable, like this is not what we are propagating, but just for a simple code, yes, this is the state of my application, basket count. Right? I have an app which is an extension from React app, a very simple way that we do. What I've done here is I've just said basket context as create context. And here, in the top level of my application, what I say is basket-context.provider. This is the provider of application. We have to kind of wrap the entire application with the provider so that anywhere within that application, we can have consumers. And I provide what is the value that I want to store within my context API. So now that I have stored this value here, whenever this value gets modified, anybody who is listening to it, they will get notification that you know that my basket icon has been modified. So now my application has this provider. After that, there is a header. And this header was basically the sufferer. So who was saying that, you know, I would probably pass on this basket count as a property. Now the header is quite happy because the header is just empty, right? There is nothing that can pass in here. So header is kind of really happy. He says that, you know, I don't care about basket count. I just have to show some nice logo and title for. I have to show the basket icon somewhere in the top right. But I don't really care about passing on that property of basket count to the basket icon. And when I go back to the basket icon, this is where my consumer sits. So a variable in my application. If I want to consume that value of basket count, then I will do the consumers. I can have the multiple places. And what it does is, this one basically is actually a render block. So, whenever I say consumers, as a child of it, I have to define a method. The variable of that method is basically whatever you have stored in your context. In this case, the basket count was what we had stored. And the output of that is another component, which is kind of using this variable. So here, what basket item says is that here this basket count, I would want to show this basket count over here. Yes, very good. Okay. So now whenever basket count changes, this variable will automatically get notified over there. So this is now how the problem. So this awesome student header, it is not really concerned anymore. It just says that okay, I am just going to have the basket icon as my child. And it is the basket icon header enough to go there and get that value, like that. Now let's go back to the second part, where you say that okay, if I click on the ads or whatever, it has got to get modified in my context. How would that happen? Let's see if I am clicking on the ads. Now, let's make our the application state that we are storing, as of now it was a single variable, let's make it an object so that we can do multiple things for it. So, what I say is, in my app component, the state of my application has one variable for this basket sum. And there is a method which can update this state. And now, from there, it is the same code again. I just have a provider, I have a header and a product now. And the product is taking this function, this will actually modify the value. So, in the product, wherever the add one is clicked, it is basically going to click on the same method again, and then that is going to go back to the application. The application is going to change the value in the product's API, and anybody who is consuming that will get to know it. So, this one always is working, this is not really the input because we will see that this add item that I am passing. This is basically actually defined in my application. So I have just defined this function over here and I am kind of passing it over here. This kind of operating happening here also. So, in a more clear way, what you really want to do is even move this method as part of my context API, like the variable which is being stored in my context. Like this. Okay. So, here, if you look at this code, what we are saying is the default state is an object which has the basket count. And now, instead of bothering my application to do all these provider thing, what we are doing is we are just creating a separate component which will handle the entire context API part. So, we are creating a component wherein I first am creating a context in basket context is this, and I am giving the default state. And after that, I am creating a component or a provider. I say state as default state, and after that, I also define the method that add item will change my basket count, or it will just implement it for one. And now, what I am really returning from this component is JSX, which actually is the provider, and it says that okay, whatever children you give me, I just render the child over here, and this is the context API, this is the variable that I want to store in the provider in the context. So as part of the variable, you see that now it's going to state as well as the method which is going to work on the state. Okay. So this is actually a must create a design because now your data and any behavior around data, both of them are actually kind of together in your context. So this is an encapsulation. So does this code look similar to you in some way? Have you used this kind of thing before? So this is closely. This provider that we are talking about, right? This is actually the Redux provider that we have. So Redux, if you said this provider, we wrap the entire application using provider and we provide the store of the application, right? So that is nothing but this kind of a provider. Where you store of your application that you are storing, that is the default state that you are storing in context in the application. And this is a simplistic code, but this is generally how it really works. It creates a context, it stores all these things there. And then whoever the children that we have passed, it just kind of renders within that. And then within the children, I can be a consumer and then I can just get updates about all these state changes. Okay, so when mock we use, this is actually from the React document itself. Why did you say don't use conscious API? Any idea why it would be so? Like, it's just a super nice feature, like, why not we use it? Because very similarity of conscious API is with global variables. It is not somehow saying that, you know, I can just create a variable which is sitting outside my application. Anybody can, you know, change it and anybody else can access it. So it's kind of, there are chances of your application code getting messed up a little bit if you don't manage your state properly. So what the job says is that don't use conscious API just to avoid blocks flowing down a few years. The block getting at least one. If that is the only problem, it's just one or two properties, it is okay. Let me let them take it. Because by creating conscious API in such a small situation, you will actually create more mess in your code. So it's okay, like you do prop stealing. But let's say in clear cases where your data is needs to be accessed in multiple components at multiple levels. So whenever there is reusability of data, let's say that basket model I'm changing, if there are four components listening to that at different places, then it actually makes sense to store this data at one common place so that everybody else can get to know about it. So if you just have one provider and one consumer, that's probably a place where you say that, well, you know, this is not really required, I probably just pass on my property. Okay, so there are three attributes. One is things we saw in our previous talk, right? The bicycle, like we demoed how to use it for thinking. So how thinning? Like you just said in context, your story that okay, currently my theme is dark. And then you just go and say that, okay, now I change my theme to light. So what happens is anybody else who has to modify their visualization, like let's say there is a button which is dark in color, the button says that okay, the theme is like I will show a light colored button. They will actually be kind of consumers to the context and they will say that okay, everybody change the theme, I will change myself. Similarly, localization, right? So I'm showing my site currently in English, but let's say wherever I have text in my page, if I want to change from English to Hindi or Marathi, then all these components, they are just listening for the language, the current active language. Wherever, let's say at application level, if I say that, okay, you know what, I don't want English, I want Hindi. In that case, all my components will have to show some kind of data. They will change their language from English to Hindi, and they will show the appropriate text. Similarly, the authorization information, let's say the user has logged in now, and you want to show that username somewhere in the top of your data. So in this kind of places, you can use REST API. If you see, the kind of usage that we are looking at is kind of very minimal. We are not really looking at storing the entire application state in context API. Another way to reuse the different logic is, let's say if I want to handle theme of my application, right, in context. What I do is, I just create one context within my application. So one more thing, you can actually create multiple contexts in your and then you can actually use it all over your place. So, context is more like your best friend. And, how many of you have kind of confided something very private to your friend, mostly in your turn? And then the responding you get together, all your other friends get to know what you do. So, context is like that. So, yesterday, for example, like before even I reached Mumbai here, my family view, my sister view, my brother view, and even my in-laws view, and everybody was asking me, have you reached Mumbai yet or not? So I just told my wife, I have lost my flight and don't tell it to anybody. And that was where I did my mistake, because the moment you don't tell, then everybody is facing me. So that is how far the safety is. We just told the van somewhere. You think that okay, you're not storing it, but anybody else who is listening to it will all get to know about it. So this is another way of creating a context API. So what we do here is, we say, okay, this is the theme context. And whenever I have this kind of a method, I give theme, and if I wrap a component with this method, what this method will do is it will return me another method with the context inbuilt. So there is already a consumer here. So whenever my theme is changing in my context, it will kind of re-render my component using the new theme, and it will return it back to me. So, let's say if I have a button like this, I can create a theme button with the HSC of button. So now, my theme button can actually listen to the changes to the theme of the application. Okay. So, we saw that you can have multiple providers in your application. So, this is kind of an example of a multiple provider in your application. You can have language provider, you can have a theme provider, there are a lot of different kind of providers. So that they are having very specific purpose. Right? So my theme provider says that I am only concerned about theme. My language says that I am only concerned about language. If you want to store any other applications here, you can have a separate provider for that. And then similarly, you can have a consumer for that. You can say, this is my theme and language consumer, wherein I have given both the consumers. And Google is my child. I am just going to pass on both the things, the language as well as the theme to them. So now I have to use this one. This is how my code will look like. My application will have the app providers, which have both the providers, the language and theme. And it also has both the consumers, the theme and the language. And all that I want to show is the theme over here, with the current theme and the current language. So whenever either the theme changes or the language changes, you always get to know about that in your page. It will automatically get created. Okay, so how context-aware help readers router now? Readers we understood, right? Like readers is kind of storing the application state, somebody is storing, somebody is getting, so they are definitely needed. But how router? So how many of you have used your React router? Awesome. So you have seen that you are defining the router mostly at the start of the application, right? And somewhere within your application you will have the route, the links, and the redirect and the component that you are using inside, right? So how do these two guys communicate with each other? So for that, the React router needs context editing so that the router can set all the values and the URL parameters, for example, that can be passed on through all these consumers. Similarly, MobX is another aspect and then the thing that you use. Okay, so this is where the thing is. So React component, right, is like the very core of the React that we use. So whenever we are getting a component, we say extend React component. Most of you who have used only the props part, right? The constructor that you would write in your component, you will probably just take the props and probably send it to super, right? But one thing that we probably never used was the second argument, which was context. So context was actually part of React for a very long time, and it was the second argument with the component. So if needed, you can always use it. It was just that they have always said that don't use it, but otherwise it's not really a new thing. We just have created a good API around it. And this is actually a code from readers, wherein you see that the context is actually being used internally to store application store. This is the child context reader. It's not very good details, but just tell you that readers actually internally was using context for a long time. So what happened was all these libraries, they were actually allowed to use context because there was a kind of trust that for the library maintainers, even if my context API keeps changing, they will change themselves and they know what they are doing. But for general users, for general developers like us, they say that you don't use it because you never know when you start overusing that, reusing the feature. So does it mean that readers is out now? Because now I can do my application state management using context API itself, right? Do I really need it? Maybe still yes, because readers, apart from handling application store, one of the best thing is that it has really evolved. Like we have this readers dev tools, right? How many of you use readers dev tools? Awesome. So you know the stupid thing that it is, like you can do time traveling and using that. It makes debugging applications so much more easy. Suddenly you see that I gave them the mango 4 times, but I see 5 in my password icon, 2 and 5th 1. You just do time travel, you just keep going one step at a time. And you get to see that the remote, there was something else that was changing it to 5. So those kind of tools are very readers and definitely for more serious applications, readers and any other state management tools, they will definitely keep coexist. From this, even the code base must be there, there is a lot more features that they provide us apart from just okay, how do we test the context API? This is the last bit of it. So let's say, I again take the example of internationalization, right? So I have this language selector. So I have a component which is considered that, let's say, there is a drop down. Right? And the drop down here is English, Hindi, Marathi, Bengali, like that, those languages. And the user just changes that. And the moment the language is changed, that has to be the active language for my application. So if I select English, English should be active. If I select English, English should be the active language. How do we test this component? So let's say that component is called language selector. And we are using context API to store this language in the context. The way we do it is, let's say I'm using Jest as my what I'll do is, I will try to mock out the context. So within my component, I will be having what we said that okay, use this context and let me create a context to store the language values. What I'll do is, I'll just mock that out and say that whenever this gets called, whenever the context is called, instead of sending whatever is there in the code, send this part. So let the list of languages be English, French, and Spanish, and the active language be English. And so now what will happen is, within my test, and this method is just going to return me language selector, the same component, but the context within that is replaced with a mock context. So now what happens is, wherever in the test, if I say that I can change to a different language, instead of calling the actual context, it will just go to this mock, and the mock will have its own predefined value. So my test says that okay, out of these three values, if I provide, will the active language be EN or not? That will be the case. Yeah, so that's about it. If you want to just play around that, the code is available in my GitHub. You can just take a look of that. There are a lot of other things apart from CPI and OGA. And